Well, good morning and welcome to worship. First Baptist Church of Martinsville, those of you here in the sanctuary, those of you at home, it is Trinity Sunday, the Sunday that we consider what it means for God to be three persons, Creator, Redeemer, Spirit, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. I especially welcome our guests here today. We're so glad that you have joined us. I have a special couple of guests. First off, Robert Chapman, thank you again for filling in for Baxter today, for the beautiful music that you bring, and for John Fulcher joining him in some duets today that are absolutely beautiful. We're also grateful for the praise team, or at least some of them, from Chatham Heights that has joined us for a song today as well. I do have a few announcements for us today. First, we offer our Christian sympathy to the family of Steve Anderson, who passed away last week. Visitation will be held at McKeystone Funeral Home tonight from 6 to 8 p.m., followed by a graveside service tomorrow at 2 p.m. at Roselawn. We also offer our Christian sympathy to Herb and David Collins and their families on the loss of their mother, Catherine Collins, who passed away this past Friday. A service will be held at King's Grant Chapel this coming Saturday at 11 a.m. This coming weekend is a very busy one in the life of our church. We are going to gather at the Henry County Food Pantry to pack food for our neighbors on Saturday morning at 10 a.m. We need to make sure that we have everyone signed up for that event. We need at least 10 to participate. And so do let the church office know if you can come. We need to have those numbers in soon. Also, that same day, that same Saturday, from 2 to 4 p.m., we are going to hold a meet and greet with our new associate pastor for families candidate, Caroline Tucker. That is a time for us, literally as a church family, just to come and meet her, to get to know her, to learn more about her. Of course, we want our families with children there, but we want everyone there to get to know Caroline. So I hope that you will make time in your busy weekend schedules to come from 2 to 4 p.m. in the fellowship hall and get to know her. We'll have some snacks available and have some time to just sit and talk. She will then join us for worship next Sunday, and during worship, she will introduce herself. She will offer a children's sermon time for our kids so that we will get to know her in a worship setting as well. We will then take an affirmation vote as a church family after worship, calling ourselves into a called business meeting. If you would like to know more about Caroline, there is a flyer and a copy of her resume out on the narthex that you can take home with you so that when you meet her, you'll have more to talk about. So feel free to take those home with you and share those with others as well. I also have a few recognitions today. First, we celebrate this weekend 1 year of ministry with Reverend David Cameron. We are so grateful for his willingness to take on a new risk of ministry, doing this shared call between our church and Chatham Heights Baptist. So we are grateful to David. I hope that you will take time this week to thank him for all of the beauty that he brings to worship and to music at our church. We're grateful to have you. And last, today is Graduate Recognition Sunday. We have had a number of people send in graduates and everything that they have completed these years. It is a wonderful season right now of students who are graduating all levels of school. We just spent Friday afternoon graduating our preschool children here in the sanctuary from our Early Learning Center. And now we are going to honor those graduating from high school and college, technical school, and graduate school. You'll find a list of these on the insert in your bulletin. All of these are either members of First Baptist or family members of those at First Baptist. And so we give thanks to God today for helping these students as they have completed their studies. Alyssa Maggs received a degree in aerospace engineering from the University of South Carolina on May 6th. She's the daughter of Regina and Rob Maggs of Lumberton, New Jersey, and the granddaughter of Marie Lanham. Taylor Robertson Vecchia received her master's degree in education with a concentration in educational leadership from James Madison University in August 2022. After passing her school leader licensure assessment, she's now licensed in pre-K to 12 administration in the state of Virginia. Francisco Frith Fernandez, or Cisco, completed his second master's degree, a Master of Arts in Teaching from Relay Graduate School of Education in May. He is the son of Marcia Frith and the grandson of Mary Frith. Rachel Leonard graduated from Pittsburgh University on April 30th. She is the daughter of Sonia Engel and Jeff Leonard and the granddaughter of Joe Engel and the late June Engel. Catherine Rooney received a degree in marine science from Eckerd University in St. Petersburg, Florida in May. She is the granddaughter of Judy Zulecki Bunin. We are so grateful that God has blessed each of these on their journeys, and we hope that we as a church family can continue to be a light in their lives as they embrace their next part of their journeys after graduation. We are grateful to all of you for submitting those names and that we can celebrate with you today. Now let us call ourselves into God's presence with a responsive call to worship. You can find this in your bulletin. I'll read the regular prints and you can respond in the bold print. Let us worship the triune God. Let us worship the triune God. Let us worship the triune God.
Let us worship the one whose spirit rests continually upon us, calling us from sorrow-filled endings to bright new beginnings.
Will you pray with me? Lord God, words are not enough to express your greatness, your majesty, and your holiness. Our highest expressions of theology are but baby talk next to who you are, next to your creation. Make us aware through your Holy Spirit that you are here among us. And may this awareness lead us to approach this hour more carefully. The words that we speak, the songs that we sing, the thoughts that we think, the joy and sadness that we feel, may these all be pleasing to you. For in spite of the inadequacy of our words, our worship today is addressed to you. Make it complete, whole, full to overflowing, O God, our rock and our redeemer. We pray this all in the name of Jesus, who taught us all to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
To join as we sing hymn number 5, Come Thou Almighty King, hymn number 5.
Thank you. Our Old Testament lesson for today is from Psalms chapter 8. O Lord, our governor, how glorious is your name in all of the world. Your mighty majesty above the heavens is praised out of the mouths of babes at the breast. You have founded a stronghold against your foes that you might still the enemy and the avenger. When I consider your heavens, the works of your fingers, the moon and the stars that you have ordained, what is man that you should be mindful of him? The son of man that you should seek him out? You have made him little lower than the angels and crowned him with glory and honor. You have given him dominion over the works of your hands and put all things under his feet. All sheep and oxen, even the wild beast of the field, the birds of the air, the fish of the sea, and whatsoever moves in the paths of the sea. O Lord, our governor, how glorious is your name in all of the world. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please stand as you are able for the reading of the gospel lesson. And our gospel lesson comes from the book of Matthew, chapter 28, verses 16 through 20. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. When they saw him, they worshiped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded to you. And remember, I am with you always to the end of the age." The Gospel of our Lord. Praise be to you, O Christ. You may be seated.
All right, I welcome our children up here. Mamas are welcome too. Come on, have a seat. All right. Have you guys seen the front of the bulletin today? Come over here so we can see together. Do y'all see this picture? So we're going to talk about what today is. So last week we celebrated a big birthday. Does anybody remember whose birthday it was? The church's birthday. That's right. We celebrated Pentecost. The Holy Spirit came down and the church was born. The Holy Spirit is one part of the Trinity. Can you say the word Trinity?
Trinity.
Trinity. Trinity is a group of three. Everybody, show me your three fingers. You got three fingers? Everybody got three fingers? You guys got three fingers? Help us out. So, there are three persons to God. So that's what this picture is. So you see there's one, two, three, and a heart holding them all together on the front of our bulletin today. So the first person of the Trinity is God. So hold up one finger, say God. So that's God the Creator. The second person of the Trinity, got two fingers? Everybody got two fingers? Show me two fingers. Second person of the Trinity is Jesus. Jesus, our Redeemer or Savior. The third person of the Trinity, got three? Everybody got three? Third person is the Holy Spirit. So God, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit, that is the Trinity. They're all one God with three persons. So we have had all sorts of things in our lives that have three things being one thing, like water. Water is sometimes wet, like liquid. Sometimes it's frozen. Sometimes it's steam, right? But you know what's different between God You know, what's different between God and three persons is that there's love. So look at this picture. Do you see one, two, and three, and a heart holds them together? So instead of just being three kinds of God, it's actually one God that loves in three ways. So when we think about God, God is God the Creator, Jesus, our Redeemer or our Savior, and the Holy Spirit, the Spirit that came down at Pentecost and gave the church a birthday. So y'all tell me, what's the first person of the Trinity?
God.
Second?
Jesus.
Third?
Holy Spirit.
Excellent. Great job. So that's how we understand God. We don't have it all figured out. We don't exactly know how it all works. But we know that God has come to us in three different ways. So let's sing a song today. It's a song you know, but we're going to add a couple verses. So the first verse, God is so good. Can you say that? God is so good. And the second verse will be, Jesus cares for me.
Jesus cares about me.
There you go. The third will be, Spirit is with me.
Spirit is with me.
So we'll sing God is so good first, and then I'll remind you what the next verse is. We ready?
God is so good. God is so good. God is so good. He's so good to me.
Jesus cares for me.
Jesus cares for me. Jesus cares for me. Jesus cares for me. He's so good to me.
Spirit is with me.
Spirit is with me. Spirit is with me. Spirit is with me. God's so good to me.
Good job, girls. All right, let's do our echo prayer before we head out. Y'all ready?
Yeah.
Loving God.
Loving God.
How are you three at once? Help us embrace your mystery.
Help us embrace your mystery.
In the name of God.
In the name of God.
Jesus.
Jesus.
And the Holy Spirit.
The Holy Spirit.
We pray.
We pray.
Amen. Good job, girls. All right. Well, I'll leave a couple of you head back. Here we go.
I ask you to stand as you are able and to join in singing hymn number 9. Sing praise to the Father, hymn number 9.
Sing praise.
the beautiful reality we live in is that we belong to God. We are God's faithful community, and we belong to each other, too. When we give from our resources, from our wallets, from our time and service, we are committing ourselves to belonging together. So as we bless these gifts received today, I hope that we remember that these are not simply obligations, but ways in which we participate in God's kingdom come to earth. Will you pray with me? Lord, bless these gifts that they may be used for ministries of compassion. Bless these people gathered here, bringing their gifts and their lives in service to you. For we offer ourselves and our gifts to you today and every day. Amen.
Thank you.
Who am I indeed? You know, I think that this question lies at the heart of what it means to be human. We're seeking to understand ourselves in relation to the created world, in relation to a higher power, in relation to one another. And it's sometimes the very lack of an answer that we have to this question that leads people toward faith. Even in the midst of a global and national crisis of faith that we face, we humans have not stopped seeking meaning and asking that question, who am I? We might not be searching for answers in the typical church down the street as much as we have in the past, but we still want something more. I was reading some psychologists' writing recently about faith and belief, and more often than not, these professionals in the human mind concurred that humans are seeking meaning from the earliest days of our lives. Young children tend to be regular believers, that even in the most trivial aspects of the natural world, they think this was created for a purpose. It's kind of 4 and 5 year old logic, right? They said if you ask children why a group of rocks are pointy, for example, they'll say something like, it's so animals won't sit on them and break them. If you ask them why rivers exist, they'll say, well, so we can go fishing. Adults are also looking for meaning, but instead of being kind of the regular answers and questions that children have, we tend toward these searches for meaning in times of uncertainty. When we feel out of control, we seek to find that control somewhere outside of ourselves. And even without a lot of religious priming, people have a bias toward the supernatural. One study found that children as young as the age of 3 attribute supernatural abilities to God, even if they haven't been taught about God. Now, of course, these psychologists aren't sold on all the philosophy and theology of it all, but even those who aren't religious will tell you, we are predisposed to believing in something more than ourselves. And you know what helps us to know about the divine, the mystery of God? It isn't just the crises in our lives, though, of course, we all know someone, perhaps even ourselves, who found God at the bottom of the barrel. There are ways we can intentionally seek the divine as well, the ways that we can know the holy other, the supernatural, that something beyond ourselves could involve prayer, meditation, this worship, gathering together. These practices that we have shared as faithful people for centuries, even millennia. It's in these holy spaces that we can focus our thoughts on the bigger questions. Who am I? Who is God? What does this all mean? I think Trinity Sunday has a way of sending us down deep theological rabbit holes where we try to chase down the mystery of God and figure it all out. How does one God have 3 persons and yet remain one God? The math just doesn't work. How do these three persons of God, how do they interact with each other? I'm afraid we're all going to just need to get out our charts. Maybe about 7 or 8 of them, I don't know. But perhaps we put the charts aside today. What else might we do on Trinity Sunday to understand the mystery of God? I think perhaps we can be a little more introspective. Instead of cognitively trying to understand the inner workings of God, I wonder if we might try to understand who we are in relationship to God. focusing on the relationship that we as humans have with this Godhead and what that might mean to a world of humans seeking meaning today. I love the Psalms because they are full of meaning-seeking humans who aren't spending a lot of time studying God with their intellect, but they're definitely getting to know God on a personal level through art. These are poems and music. They pray and sing to God about every facet of their lives. They ask for help. They give thanks. They cry and shake their fist at God. And they recognize who they are in those holy moments as they stand in the face of the divine. Our psalm for today, Psalm 8, is one of the creation psalms. It's an individual psalm of praise that recognizes who God is and who the psalmist is in relationship to God. I would encourage all of you to pull out your Bibles today, or your Bible apps. That's okay too. Let's find Psalm 8 together and take a look at it. Because I think each verse gives us a little bit more understanding. Verses 1 and 2 are celebrating God's sovereignty over the world. This God, the psalmist sings about, rules over all and has the ability to avenge over enemies. In other words, the psalmist recognizes that it is God who ultimately has the final say and not humanity. Verse 3 recognizes God as creator. It's really quite beautiful. One of the other passages we didn't read today from our lectionary is the creation story from Genesis 1. I'm reminded as the psalmist stares at the vastness of the universe displayed in the sky, moon, and stars, that even the most seasoned astrophysicist or astronomer often does the same. The more we learn about our universe, the more in awe of it we tend to be. Even biology hobbyist pastors find themselves on top of mountains, staring at the starry sky and wondering just how powerful the God who created this is. Then in verse 4, begins to pan away from the sovereignty of God, this God that's over here, and looks toward the psalmist and other humans. What are human beings that you're mindful of them, mortals that you care for them? This vastness that we see in the heavens could easily make us feel insignificant or alone. But the psalmist sees instead a God who chooses to have a relationship with humanity, each and every one of us. This very same God who created all we can see and more wants to know us. In verse 6 through 8, this is the psalmist reminding us that God gave us not just this world to live in, but also to be a part of. God wanted us to be co-creators as we tend these mighty works that have been created. The psalmist says we are only a little lower than God. In Genesis 1, we read, we are created in the image of God. And we have our meaning and purpose from God. From our keeping of the animals to our command of the earth's growth, we are a people given task by a sovereign God who created everything. Creative task in this world, to love and to cherish this earth as a gift, to subdue it in ways that are good, in ways God would love this earth. So, who am I in light of who God is? I think the psalmist gives us some answers. I'm important because I am loved by God. so loved by God that I was created to partner with God in the care of all of creation. Isn't that a powerful message of belonging? God said, you belong here. You are meant to be part of my love, part of all of the beauty that surrounds you. You, little old me, little old you. And I would add to our psalmist, the rest of the creation story then involves the fall of humanity, right? I mean, we chose not to continue to live in the harmony and goodness with God. We chose to seek our own selfish pathways. And you know what our psalmist still points out? We are still meant to participate with God. It's harder now. The work is plagued with illness and struggle and strife. But we are still called to this work, even after the fall. It is our birthright as God's beloved children to be co-creators with God. What are humans that you're mindful of us? The psalmist asks. We are God's pinnacle of creation, made in God's very image and meant to love this created world as God did when God created it and called it good. We might be, as that song we just heard suggested, a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow, a wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor in the wind, and yet, still there is a God who is mindful of us, who seeks us. And you know, it might just be that the Holy Trinity can help us expand on our beautiful hymn from the psalmist. Because in the doctrine of the Trinity, as the church understands it, we learn that God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit are in constant relationship, a kind of self-giving love that is eternally present and flows outward from the Godhead to the created world through all of us. I imagine that as Jesus called those earliest disciples to go and tell everyone about his good news of the kingdom of God come to earth, that they didn't miss that he did so by saying they should baptize people in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. These three persons of God bring to us the hopeful reality that community can be built on God's self-giving nature if we are as mindful of God as God is of us. We can choose to get out of our own ways and live in a co-creating relationship with others if we are in regular connection with God through prayer, through corporate worship. When we gather as community, something that should be a priority in our lives, we choose to be present with God and with each other so that that relationship of co-creating can be made manifest in real and powerful ways. And when we face the harsh realities of life, we can remember Jesus' promise to those first disciples. I am with you always, even into the end of the age. So what happens when we answer meditatively, prayerfully, the question, who am I? I think it gives meaning to the good news Jesus told those first disciples and told us to share. It helps us to connect the dots for those seeking connection with the divine, because we're not just reciting doctrines, but sharing a lived experience of the enormity of God's love. God's love for creation, God's love incarnate in Christ, God's love infused into the church with the Holy Spirit. So let us ask, and ask freely in prayer and petition in our worship, and hear God's answer. Who am I? Loved by God, a God who from time immortal has lived in three persons, whose Son entered our midst and gave up so much, whose Spirit infuses our worship and convicts our souls. Who am I? A child of the Most High, the sovereign of all creation, a brother to Christ the Son, or a sister to Christ the Son, who chose to sacrifice on my behalf, a receiver of God's Holy Spirit, who lives by faith and the powerful spirit wind that moves me day by day. Who am I? I like the answer to who I am when I seek God in worship, as our psalmist did. And I hope that you do too. As our praise song brought to us today, it's not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am yours. I think it's fitting that the day we discuss who we are is our Communion Sunday. Because as we observe communion, remembering Christ's sacrifice, we are also consistently answering that question, who am I? I am so loved by God that God would choose to live like me as a human. And he would not only live, but he would die and overcome death so that we might fully live and live abundantly. As we gather around this table, I remind you that this is not my table. This is a table for all God's people. It's not my table. It's not First Baptist table. It doesn't belong to anyone but Jesus Christ. Anyone who calls on Jesus as Lord is welcome here. I believe that when we approach this table of shared remembrance, we do so with a sense of awe and also responsibility. Here we not only remember Christ's life, death, and resurrection, we also remember that we are not perfect, and yet we are loved. So looking in your bulletin, we will pray together a unison prayer of confession, a time to admit where we have fallen short, and to receive the grace of God anew. Will you pray with me? Holy and triune God, you alone live in perfect relationship, one God in three persons, mutual and loving, ever seeking reconciliation and unity. You have called us to live in your completion, yet we confess that our relationships are imperfect and we are incomplete without you. We are selfish and greedy. We are anxious and resentful. We feel the shame of our foolish behavior and brokenness. We have allowed sin to drive us apart from one another and from you. Forgive us and restore us. Draw us close and bind us together in your mercy. Friends, Christ shared the good news with his disciples. We are forgiven and free. Hear that good news in these moments as we have confessed our sins. You belong to God. And because of Christ's sacrifice Nothing can separate you from the love of Christ, the power of the Holy Spirit, the very presence of the Creator in your life. You are forgiven and free. You belong to God. And I encourage you now to remember that night when Jesus gathered with his friends in the upper room, and he prepared a meal, and he took the loaf of bread, and he said, "This is my body broken for you," and he broke the bread and shared it with his friends, and how he took the cup, and he said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Each time you eat this bread or drink this cup, you remember the Lord's death until he comes again." So taking out of the bottom of your communion the bread, remember, this is the bread of heaven, and take and eat. remember. As Jesus blessed that wine, he said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Drink and remember." Will you join me in a prayer of thanksgiving? You can find this in your bulletin. We will read this in unison together. Thanks be to God, who is mindful of us. Though we fall short of this perfect unity, may we, with God's creative power, Christ's servant leadership, and the Holy Spirit's inspiration and power, learn to love and be loved as God loves us. Now, my friends, as God's beloved children, gathered in community, will you stand up, grab your neighbor's hand, and let us sing together, "Bless be the tie that binds."